this incredible elder, Dean here today, who wants to say words for a couple of minutes.
Hi, folks. So, many of your groups here do you understand the organisation known as the OSTF? Right, this document here, what I have in my hand, is the Midgeable Tribal Discretionary Trust. So all the lands from Southport to Byron Bay and out to Nimbin have now been claimed by the Midgeable tribe. Okay, we've got Arnie here beside me. She's one of the Midgeable elders. Okay, so what this means is this. The New South Wales Police and the Queensland Police Forces, now our border boundary goes into, actually, Southport, to Byron Bay and out to Nimbin. Now, what they've done at the moment, they've actually shut this border, as you can all see, while we're all here. Okay, so anyone who, does anyone here have protection notices from the OSTF? Yes. Right, what we would like you to do is to serve all your local government members with those protection notices. You send one by email and you send one by snail mail registered post. Okay, this border should be down within a week. Okay, so what we need is this whole community here that are suffering from this border being closed. You serve it on the police stations, all the local government areas, the schools, if you don't want your kids vaccinated, protection notices to all the schools. In the Northern New South Wales region, 63 schools have been notified by myself. They will not go near our children on these schools. If they do, it will be a war crime. Okay, so why yous are all here today? If anyone harasses you, police force wise, whatever, you get their name, badge numbers, you come and see me. All right, so you are under the protection of the Midgeable Sovereign Tribal Council. Okay? So that is our agreement to you. You, by living on our land, we have the protection notice given to you because you didn't know what they did 230 years ago, and they have hoodwinked you into believing that this was all different. What they did was stitch our people up, and now they're doing the same to you. Thanks, folks.
Thank you, Dean. I really appreciate that. Thank you for being here today to support us. Brother Jambi here is going to walk through the crowd, and when he gets to the front of the crowd, we're all then going to follow him up the hill. And then we're going to take a moment up the hill. So move your bodies, get comfortable, listen for the clapsticks, and when he gets there, let's start walking up. Again, can I reiterate, this is a joyful moment. We are not angry, we are not shouty, there are lots of children around. We are happy and we are in our power in this moment in time. Everyone coming closer, I have just been told that we've got over 10,000 people here right now. Their jobs but their lifelong dreams. Graham time shot to social media fame opposing government policies on mandatory vaccinations in the very infamous viral video he made, which many of you have seen. Graham Hood is here to talk to us today. An incredibly courageous man standing up against his entire industry who often feels alone. And I'm so glad that there's so many thousands of you today who says you are not alone. Graham Hood, welcome.
You're not contagious. There's a news helicopter flying over that will tonight report there were 200 people here. Did any of you see the rally in Melbourne yesterday? There were only 3,000 there. And apparently they all behaved like animals. What happens to good people when you cage them up for 2 years? They don't behave like animals. I don't know. I come to these things and I say the things I say, and I don't prescript it. I've got no idea what's going to come out of my mouth. Pity I didn't think about that 3 months ago. But I want to tell you this. That the things that made me angry then still make me angry today. And one of those was watching Princess Anastasia Palaszczuk on the Sunrise program when she was announcing with great joy the roadmap to freedom for Queensland. And that bastion of truth, David Koch, that bastion of truth asked her a question, and he said, how long are you going to leave Queenslanders stuck on the New South Wales side of the border? And she said, till the 17th. And he said, that's a bit harsh. And she said, no, it isn't. And then they said to her, are you going to keep building all these camps? And she said, oh, yeah. Yeah, we're going to keep building all the camps. It's for them. That's why it's so good, right? And Koshy said, what are you building the camps for now if it's all over? Oh, well, there'll be people coming in from overseas and we'll probably need them for those anti-vaxxers. Because this is the pandemic of the anti-vaxxed, the non-vaxxed. And Koshy just said, oh. Anastasia, no. I hope you've picked a really good room out for yourself. Because we're all going to say what we've become used to saying for a long time. Nah. What are we going to say to Anastasia?
No.
Nah. Did it feel good to say nah?
No.
To all you Qantas people in this crowd, and there are a lot of you, there's a lot of family members in here, a lot of ex-Australian Airlines people that I grew up with in the airline industry. There's no way that the little Irish leprechaun is the Spirit of Australia. You are! You are! And he seems to have a right to say whatever he wants under the brand of Qantas, as an employee of Qantas, and so do I. And so do you. And so do you. I want to thank the thin blue line. The thin blue line is thickening up. The thin blue line is finding its strength again by the way it's behaving here at this gathering today, and I honour you. And I honour the brave police officers who spoke earlier for bringing them a conscience they needed to hear. I've been making a daily video because I've been asked by so many people. We get 30,000 messages a week without fail, and I really apologise. We cannot answer them all, but we really feel the love. I want to warn you all about that scammer that's trying to fleece you all. Many of you have contacted Facebook, as I have, and they examined it. And they said they find nothing against their community standards by that post. But you dare mention ivermectin. You dare mention ivermectin, and it's another story. 7-day ban. So please, if you get a friend request from me on Facebook, ignore it. I want to be your friends. I will accept friend requests, but I won't send them out because of that. So just know that your love and support and the messages you come through, they just flood us and they're beautiful. Michelle and I run this from our kitchen table. Michelle, come here, please. Come here, please. She's got more strength and more courage than 100 men I've ever met. And she's the reason I didn't kill myself in 2006. And she said, don't you dare do anything today to elevate me. She likes to be in the shadows, but I hate it when she's in the shadows. I have been in my daily videos closing with a prayer because thousands of you are asking for it. Now, I may seem old-fashioned. I've got a bit of grey hair. And I love the Anzacs. I love the spirit of the Anzacs. I just love the relic of their trust that they gave us. And I love the fact that they've given us something we can honour and respect. And it breaks my heart that we're not. It breaks my heart that bullets, rubber bullets, were ricocheting off the Shrine of Remembrance. And the people I know who were at the Shrine of Remembrance in Melbourne were there because they felt safe being there. They went there because they wanted to be close to the spirit of the Anzacs. And they were fired upon. And they were fired on by police officers, some of who I've spoken to, who deeply regret that they were called on to do that. So, I want to recant a story about bravery that connects with war. It's not about a brave Australian, it's about a brave American. His name was Desmond Doss. Yes. Have any of you heard of Desmond Doss?
Yes.
Desmond Doss was a young Seventh-day Adventist Christian boy raised in a dysfunctional family in the Midwest. During World War II, he felt the call to serve his country, but he couldn't raise arms. He couldn't hold a firearm. Desmond joined the army, hoping that he'd become a medic, a combat medic. And he was trained in the army camp, in this fort, wherever it was in America. and he was told that he had to do KP duty and drill on a Saturday, and he said, I can't do it on a Saturday, that's the Sabbath of the Lord my God. And that's the Sabbath of the Lord my God. And I honour that. That's my creed to God. And I have made a promise. In fact, this rally today is happening on Sunday, because when it was planned to happen yesterday, I told the organisers I couldn't come because my allegiance is first to my God. And within 15 minutes, the wonderful people who organised this event called me up and said, we're going to change it to Sunday. And I really thank them for that. The reason that's so important to me is because God comes first, Michelle and my family come second, and my country come third. And it will always be that way. And if there's any ounce of integrity in my soul, it comes from because I live that way under Christ. That's just me. Desmond Doss had the same view. Desmond Doss was persecuted by his platoon because he wouldn't take up a rifle in rifle duty. They tried everything they could to persecute him out of the army, to give him a Section 8, and he refused. On the day of his wedding, he was locked in a cell and wasn't allowed to attend his wedding. And he didn't break. He held the line. And in holding the line, he appeared in a court-martial and he begged them to let him go into combat, not carrying a weapon but a first aid kit. And they finally relented and they told him on his head be it. And the rest of his platoon treated him like dirt because they felt they couldn't trust him. And then they went to Okinawa and they landed on the beach at Okinawa and they went to a place called Hacksaw Ridge. You've seen the movie. And there was a rope ladder 150 feet up a sheer cliff. And Desmond and his platoon went up there to relieve soldiers who'd been decimated on the top of the ridge by the Japanese who were defending their homeland. And when they got up there, they met with unspeakable horror. There were men being blown to pieces everywhere, and they were tripping over body parts. And Desmond ran from one wounded soldier to another, administering morphine. And every soldier grabbed him and said, Desmond, don't leave me. Please don't leave me. And he'd say, I'll be back, I promise I'll never leave you, I'll be back. I've heard that from Jesus. I promise you I'll never leave you. And then he went off to treat other soldiers. And then when the battle became so intense and the Americans had to withdraw and go back down the rope ladder, Desmond was one of the last to go down and he looked back and he could see all the soldiers lying there that he promised he would help. And he stayed. And all the other soldiers escaped wounded down the rope ladder. And Desmond stayed. And somebody said, where's Doss? And the commanding officer said, we don't know where he is. What's he doing? And an hour later after dark, a wounded soldier was lowered down on a rope 150 feet down the cliff face. And Desmond was holding onto the rope at the top. And he did that 75 times in one night. He went out into the battlefield, digging up soldiers he'd buried for protection while Japanese soldiers were bayoneting the wounded. And he did that 75 times and there was no skin left on his hands. And as he did that, he was absolutely gutted and exhausted. And he looked to God and he said, just one more. Just one more. We have to say that about our kids. You're not going to touch our kids. You're not going to inject our kids. And so Desmond did that. And that after the next day, Desmond had got everyone down that he could and he was lowered himself to the ground. And they took him away and they cleaned him up. And there was a first aid tent filled with soldiers, Japanese and American, that he lowered down. Japanese and American. In our climate, you might say vaxxed and unvaxxed. Yeah. It didn't matter to Desmond and it doesn't matter to me. Yeah. And he lowered them down. And after a couple of days of rest, they said, we've got to go back and take the hill. It's all right, my son-in-law, he's a FIFO miner in WA and he's about to lose his job. And so the next day, they planned a battle and Desmond said, can we please do it the next day because tomorrow is my Sabbath. And the platoon held back and the platoon said, we're not going up unless Desmond's going up. The platoon that condemned him in training and said he was gutless and they could never trust him on the battlefield, they said, we're not going until Desmond goes up. And so the next day they planned to climb up the ladder for the final battle. And the commanding officer in HQ further down the beach said, why haven't you gone yet? And they said, we can't go yet, sir, Desmond's praying. Yeah. And Desmond was quietly praying. And when they were ready and he was ready, they all went up the hill and they defeated a powerful Japanese force and Desmond was nearly killed. I dare to be Desmond. I dare you to be Desmond. Who will be Desmond with me? Desmond Doss lived to a ripe old age. He lived as a man of honour who, as a non-combatant and a brave, conscientious objector, because he said nah, he was awarded the highest medal of bravery in the world, the Congressional Medal of Honour. The Congressional Medal of Honour. And everything he did because he felt Jesus driving him every step of the way, and that's why I'm doing what I'm doing. And I make no apologies for that. So where do we go from here? When I stood on this stage a few weeks ago, I was fighting for the spirit of Australia. And I look at you and I see the fight was won. Yeah. I look at you and I see the hope for the future of our kids and grandkids. I look at you and I know that every ounce of sweat and blood we're putting into this battle is worth every drop. Every single drop. So, is Diana Maitland anywhere? Diana Maitland, I need you to step up if you're around anywhere, Diana. Diana Maitland is an incredible lady who, when I was being snowed under by messages from people who were threatening to take their own lives because they lived under the calm and benevolent rulership of Dictator Dan, I called out for help. And within an hour, an enterprising young Scottish lass, a nurse who's lost a job, formed a group called Hoodies Helpers on Facebook. She did. And Hoodies Helpers has grown from that to tens of thousands of members with Hoodies Helpers branches in every state in Australia and New Zealand. And what are they there for? They're there to tell you that you are no longer alone. They're there to offer support. If you go on the Telegram page and you're down and out and you feel like this is the end and that you're about to be coerced into something that's against your will, they're there to back you and support you no matter what your decision and what decision you've made prior to that. They're offering support such as Zoom school meetings for teachers who are unemployed who still want to teach kids. How many teachers in this group today? Amazing people. How many nurses? How many paramedics? You're lying. You can't be. You're all idiots. You've made a stupid decision. You must be crazy. You all have a role to play in the new Australia that we're going to build. You all have a role to play in the new society that we need to show them what needs to happen. And we're going to show them in a way that they've never thought possible. We can't go back to the old normal because it sucked back then. And the new normal being promoted by Klaus Schwab and his team sucks even worse. So we got to be the change that we want to be. And so I want to thank all of you for being part of that. I want you to spread the word about Hoodies Helpers and any other support group. Your strength lies in your vulnerability. Your strength lies in your capacity to love one another, no matter what decisions that you make. And if you don't do that, we're all toast. If you love God, love him now more than you ever did. And if you've been considering it, find a way to get to him. He's not hard. I happen to feel like he's standing right beside me at the moment. I pray about everything I do, and every time I pray about should I do this or shouldn't I do that, a door opens and I walk through it, and I feel blessed every time. And if he ever shuts the door, I'll give it up. So in the honour of that, I ask you who believe, and those of you who just like to respect what I'm doing, to bow your heads with me. Lord Father in heaven, we are your children. We belong to you. You numbered every hair on the top of our head, every molecule in our body. And we know that you were sacrificed on the cross for our freedom. And Lord, your cross was planted on a hill, which is where we plant our flag. And we stand under the cross of freedom, in the blood of Christ, to say that love does conquer all, and know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. So, Father, grant us the serenity to accept the things that we cannot change, and the courage to change the things that we can, and the wisdom to know the difference, living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace, taking as Jesus did this sinful world as it is and not as I would have it, trusting that you will make all things right if I surrender to your will, so that I can be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with you forever in the next. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for coming out.
Today, and before we do, we've just got a closing with Auntie Lila. Auntie Lila has been a teacher for 50 years, and the funny thing is, it just landed on today, and today marks the 50th anniversary of the day that she got arrested for